Please rise. Grace, mercy, and peace to you from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Our text this morning is a portion, a very small portion, of the Holy Gospel, beginning at verse 4. This took place to fulfill what was spoken by the prophet, saying, "Say to the daughter of Zion, behold, your king is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a beast of burden." This is the word of the Lord given to us this first Sunday in Advent. Thanks be to Jesus. Please be seated. My dearest brothers and sisters in Christ Jesus, it was 1979, and yes, we were out painting rocks and putting everything in order, making sure everything was spick and span, because the president was coming to visit. And just before the president came to visit, everything looked wonderful. It was almost perfect. And then he canceled. The coming of a queen, the coming of a prince or princess. There's a lot of fanfare. There's no mistake who is coming. It's the queen who is coming, or it's the prince who is coming, or it's the princess who is coming, or it's the president who is coming, unless they cancel at the last second. Yet today, each and every one of us are gathered here to hear about the coming of our Lord Jesus. He doesn't come with fanfare. He doesn't come dressed in royal robes. He doesn't come riding in a limo or a very fancy carriage. Yet there's no mistaking. There's no mistaking who is coming. Coming. Advent means coming. And we've learned, understandably, to link the season what is soon to come. After Advent comes Christmas. It's always that way, and it will never change until our Lord comes the second time. Yet, just as we get this yearly reminder of the true meaning of Christmas, we also do well to learn the true meaning of Advent. Advent is not about, dear ones, all the hustle and bustle of Black Friday. It's not about all the cheap marketing ploys that you're going to be deluged with, commercial after commercial after commercial. It's not about the secularization of the nativity of our Lord Jesus. Advent is not about what is coming. Advent is about who has come and will come again. Jesus Christ, your Savior. Yet, we're not waiting for him to be born. We already know that that has happened some 2,000 years ago in a little village called Bethlehem. No, during this season, we joyfully await in excitement, in anticipation, while we're just bubbling over with joy, that our King is coming and he will not cancel. He won't cancel at the last second. He has kept all of his promises. And that one final promise, he will keep. He will come again. And as we hear in the book of Luke, we will lift up our heads and we will behold our salvation. For the King of glory will come. The King of kings and the Lord of lords. He will return in power to judge all men at his second advent. At his second coming. In our Holy Gospel this morning, we hear about another coming of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords, the first coming. We hear, "Behold, your King is coming to you, humble and mounted on a donkey." You know, for the entrance of a king into his capital city, you would think that the scene would be more, well, flamboyant. Humble? Really? The king comes humbly? Where's his army? Where's all of his attendants? Where's all of his guards? Riding on a donkey? Really? Where's his war horse, his great white stallion that shows that he is the one who's large and in charge? Isn't very impressive, is it? He comes in no royal robe. He comes with no crown on his head. He doesn't come riding in with a guard, an army, after soldier, after soldier, after soldier. And he doesn't come riding in on a great white stallion, a war horse. No, he comes riding in on the foal of a donkey. A borrowed donkey at that. The King of Kings riding on a humble beast of burden. Why, kings don't ride into cities that way. They don't come into a city in humble submission. But when it comes to the King of the universe, your King, Jesus Christ, who is the eternal Son of God, it's a good thing that he did not come with a great display of power and glory. Therefore, dear ones, take comfort. Take comfort and know that your King entered Jerusalem in humility and riding on the foal of a donkey. He came humbly, riding on a humble beast of burden, so that they could live and so that you and I could live. Jesus riding into Jerusalem, the city of peace, for that's what Jerusalem means, city of peace, in such a way was actually a fulfillment of his very own prophecy given to the prophet Zechariah. And you know that prophecy was given 520 years before the event. Why, this nation is only 230 some years old, and this prophecy, 520 years. Rejoice greatly, daughter Zion. Shout, daughter Jerusalem. See, your King comes to you, righteous and victorious, lowly, and riding on a donkey, on a colt, the foal of a donkey. So why? Why does Jesus enter the city of peace on a donkey? He did so because he came to his own people not to conquer them, but to be killed by them. He rode into Jerusalem on that first Palm Sunday, preparing for Good Friday. The King had to die for his people, the daughter of Zion, his own people. They did not receive him, and they did not believe that he was the Messiah. They did not believe that he is the King. Yet he came to them in this way, humbly, almost unbelievably, so that he could die for their sin and die for your sin and die for my sin. It's very comforting to know that your King Jesus still comes to you in accord with his grace and his humility and his mercy. If Jesus were as impatient as we are, we would be in very serious trouble. After all, the psalmist writes for us, "If thou, O Lord, shouldest mark iniquities, O Lord, who could stand? But there is forgiveness with thee, that thou mayest be feared." The Lord God did immediately destroy Jerusalem. He could have certainly done that. He could have rejected his own people with a snap of a finger. But he did reject them 40 years later. And so complete was the destruction of Jerusalem that not one stone was left on top of another. Rejoice, dear ones, rejoice, I say. Rejoice that your King does not come to you and destroy you. Rather, he comes to you. He seeks you. He opens your heart to his word. He opens your utter darkness of the heart, and he shines his light on your heart and he drives away the darkness. And therefore the fruits that follow are his work, which he works through you. You see, our own hearts condemn us. We know that God's law is written on our hearts. You and I, we know the Ten Commandments, yet we break them daily and much. You break the commandments, and I break the commandments. No one is exempt. Yes, our hearts condemn us, yet your King continues to come to you, in love and in gentleness and in patience, with a promise of the forgiveness of all your sin. When you and I realize, when we finally realize how serious of a pickle we are really in, despite our best efforts to lead a God-pleasing life, we can take comfort. We can take comfort in knowing just how gracious and merciful and forgiving is your King. Jesus doesn't come to you, dear ones. He doesn't come and give to you what you deserve and what I deserve. He doesn't come in his holy wrath, and he doesn't cast us into the outer darkness where there is weeping and gnashing of teeth. Oh, that will happen. But thanks be to Jesus that it won't happen to us. Rather, he comes to us. He comes to us and gives to us what you and I do not deserve. Full pardon, peace, forgiveness, which surpasses all understanding. Jesus entered into Jerusalem riding on an animal of peace. He did this for his people then. He did that for his people even today. He went there a final time. He went there as the Lamb of God who has taken away the sins of the world, and he shed his most holy and precious blood for all of their sins and for all of your sins. And Jesus continues to come to you, dear ones. He continues to come to you humbly. He doesn't come to you in over-the-top productions. He doesn't come in emotional frenzies, but humbly. Humbly he comes in the preached word and in the blessed holy sacraments. Who would think that God would attach his saving word of promise to water? But he does. In the waters of holy baptism, he washes away all of your sins and he gives you newness of life. He does this in the sacrament of holy baptism. Who would think that God would deliver his word to you through a sinful, unworthy man instead of a booming voice from heaven? That's what we would expect. But God comes humbly. He comes humbly in a sinful servant, and he proclaims to you law and gospel, the law that convicts us of our sins and shows us that we cannot save ourselves. And then he proclaims the sweetness of the gospel to us, to show us, to tell us, so that we will believe that he has done this great work of dying on the cross so that you can live forever. Who would think that your King and Savior would come to you in a tiny little wafer and a sip of wine? But he does. He gives to you here. He is personally present to give to you his body and blood. Yes, for the forgiveness of your sins, but to strengthen your faith, for he knows that your faith is weak. He knows that you need him. So he comes to you humbly and gentle in wafer and in wine. He does this because of his love, because of his grace, because of his mercy for you. In the Sanctus, we sing the same, very same words as Jesus rode in humbly on that beast of burden, the people lining the streets, those who believed that he was the Messiah, they proclaimed, "Hosanna, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who cometh in the name of the Lord." You and I must rejoice. We must rejoice that our King has come, that he has come to save us. As ordinary and unimpressive as it may seem, week after week after week. You see, the world isn't impressed with all of this. The world thinks it has to do something even more marvelous. The church thinks it has to do something more marvelous. They have to do something to kind of wake God up and to show God that they are the faithful ones. Yet God doesn't come this way. Jesus was never impressed, dear ones. He was never impressed with the opinions of the world. He's never impressed with our works. He's never impressed with what we proclaim. He's only concerned about what we need from him. Body, blood, word, water. We, O Lord, need your word. And we need your sacraments. Therefore today we rejoice. Yes, we rejoice, for we know that he has come and that he is coming a second time. And this second time, he's not coming in secret. He's not coming to be born as a babe, to be laid in a manger. No, he's coming as Lord and King. He will be on his war horse, and he will have in his hand the mighty two-edged sword to judge the peoples, either according to the law or according to the sweetness of his gospel. Rejoice, O daughter of Zion, and give thanks that your King has come to you, that he is coming continually to you, that he is coming this very moment to you, as you hear his words of peace, as you hear his words of joy, as you hear his words of promise. Therefore, finally, we close by giving you hope. Yes, the season of Advent is also about hope. We know that he has come, and that hope that you have is the hope that you know that your King will humbly come once again with great power and glory, not coming to the cross, but coming to his people to save us, and to take us into his kingdom. He does this because your sins have been forgiven. Therefore, rejoice in the forgiveness of all of your sins, knowing that your King is here today and he is coming to you. Your King is coming to you in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Thanks be to Jesus. Amen. Please rise. The peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus, now and forever. Amen.